expat living in the U.S. to the U.S. expat living in the U.K. Lynn Murphy teaches linguistics at the University of Sussex in England and has been in the U.K. for 18 years now?
18 and a third. Not that I'm counting.
You may know her from her wonderful blog, Separated by a Common Language, which has been going for at least a decade now. We're very pleased to have her talking about her book, The Prodigal Tongue, out from Penguin, and specifically talking about something good for our crowd here, two dictionary cultures.
So, thank you very much, Ben. And like Jez, I'm also to say Scrivener is how I wrote my book. I have become an evangelist for it. So if you're writing a book, check that. So I've written this book about the love-hate relationship between British and American English. If you buy it in Britain, or if you buy it in America, it's between American and British English. This is the American cover. But what I'm going to talk about today is something that I touch on in chapter 8 of the book. Chapter 8 is called The Standard Bearers, and it deals a little bit about how we deal with dictionaries and prescriptive rules in the two countries. But this is going to go a bit deeper into the research that I did, that did make it into the book. Much of which I presented at the Dictionary Society of North America conference in Barbados. And if you didn't go to that, you're a fool. But I'm making it up to you by presenting it. I apologize to a couple of people who have seen much of this before. So, Randolph Quirk, this is one of the first things I read when I started working on this project. He wrote, "It is hazardous to embark on topics as enmeshed in folklore as the influence of the dictionary or Anglo-American differences. To embark on both simultaneously is a little short of foolhardy." And I have to say, I'm not short of foolhardy at all, because I've gone in head first, looking at these two things. And what I've been interested in, and this was part of a project funded by the British Academy to look at dictionary cultures in the two countries, were what are the, what does the dictionary mean in one country or the other? What does it mean to people? How do people think of it? And how do dictionary publishers feed those thoughts? How do dictionary publishers take part in that dictionary culture, those attitudes? And I was reminded putting this together of a story that was told to me twice when I visited Merriam-Webster in 2016. So I was there, I was using their archives, and two different people at two different times who worked there said to me, I remember the time that Robert Birchfield came and visited us in Springfield. And Birchfield at the time was the editor of the Oxford English Dictionary. And everybody at Merriam-Webster was very eager to show Birchfield Philip Gove's black books. And these were binders, black binders, in which the former, the editor of Webster's Third International, had written down all the rules for making a dictionary entry. They're thick binders full of detail, about how you define a color, and where you put the punctuation, how you do the, all sorts of. So they proudly showed Birchfield these books, and they said, "Oh, but of course, you've got the same thing at Oxford." And he was like, "No. No, actually, we don't. We don't have anything like this. We just sort of do it." He probably didn't put it that way. But that just took the people at Webster aback. Because, they were like, this is what you need to write a dictionary. But that wasn't the attitude about writing a dictionary. That was, what Birchfield was doing. And this urge to write things down, to have the rules written down, is something that I see as something that Americans are particularly fond of doing, particularly good at. One of the examples I like to refer to is the American Constitution, which is like 8,000 words long, and it determines everything in our country, essentially, in various ways. But in Britain, there is no such thing as a written constitution, no codified constitution. The constitution is a collection of traditions and, whatever laws are there at the time. But you can never in Britain declare something unconstitutional because the Constitution isn't fixed. So a couple of years ago, well, a few more than a couple, they had a parliamentary committee to look into, should we have a written constitution? I mean, it seemed like a very European Union thing to do, but in a very British way, they decided not to. And one of the things that they said about it but is that a written constitution is unnecessary, undesirable, and most of all, un-British. That, you know, to write stuff down is to ignore our great history in some way, which almost seems contradictory to something from another culture. So I'm thinking about sort of the cultures of literacy in the two countries and some of the things that strike me. And of course, we're very similar countries. We have shared history. There's a lot that's the same. I'm talking about really, really subtle differences here that you know, we want to be careful about. But at the same time, in the United Kingdom, you see some preference for unspoken rules that are learned by osmosis. And this is sort of a feature of the class system in England, where, you know, you sort of have to know, you have to be born and brought up in a certain way in order to know how to use the English language in the received way. So the United Kingdom, I would say, you know, in terms of its relationship with rules, is used to something where rules are given from on high, from the aristocracy, from the high church, an uncodified constitution, received English, and a mild feudalism, I have to say, pervades the country, having lived there really 20 years. Whereas the United States has some preference for written rules, for direct teaching of how to do things, rather than learning by osmosis, and for self-help. And so part of my case here is that the dictionary in the United States is a self-help tool in a way that maybe it isn't everywhere else in the world. And so we can compare this with you. So the people who settled the United States, the English people who settled the United States, and so the Germans, so they were coming from low church traditions where you didn't wait for what to do from on high. You had to read your Bible. You had to have a personal relationship with the word, which encouraged a certain kind of literacy, which meant that by, you know, by the 1820s, the United States was the most literate country in the world as well. Codified constitution. When we talk about our standard English, we don't talk about received English. We don't talk about what's used at the highest schools of the nation and things like that. We talk about standard English, we talk about network English, we talk about English in the middle, right, rather than the English from the top. And of course there's this can-do attitude that goes along with that self-help thing. This is a chart that's in the book. It's my favorite chart in the book. I've wasted so much time on making this chart. I went through Amazon's top 100 bestseller list for 5 years and looked at all the instructional books, you know, books that told you how to do something, how to drive, how to make friends and influence people, all that kind of stuff. And you can see here that in Britain, the same number of instructional books sell in the two countries, but in Britain, they're almost entirely about cooking and dieting. It's like a single book sale. And there are a few, like Marie Kondo's Joy of Tidying Up book, and things like that were also in there. But in America, it's the other way around. We still cook and eat, God knows. But a lot more self-help books tell you how to be a better person. You know, how to be psychologically more together, how to have better relationships, all those kinds of things, which just weren't on the list in Britain in the same kind of numbers. And so I like to think about that in terms of thinking about dictionaries. Our dictionaries there to be self-help books in America. And here, of course, I am talking, I should pause and say, I am mostly talking about the dictionaries that are written for English speakers. Dictionaries written for second language users of English are going to be a different matter, but that's an interesting cross-country comparison as well. But anyway, here's Jonathan Green, slang lexicographer, noting that British lexicography has on the whole a different agenda from We like the stories of words. Where did such and such come from? Whereas Americans like to know their status. Can I use it thus? Is it right or wrong? And so there were a few studies of dictionary usage among university or college students in the 70s and 80s. And you saw that difference in those studies where British people did not use dictionary, British students did not use dictionaries as often as American students have. The American students in the 70s and 80s probably will have been given a dictionary as a graduation present from high school and would go to college. And so, they got one too. But when the British people were looking up things, they were more likely than Americans to look up synonyms and to look up etymologies. Americans were more likely to look up definitions and look up spellings and conjugations. So we sort of see that in the past. And we see it then in how the dictionaries present themselves to the potential buyers or potential users. So these are British dictionary taglines, so they're on the dust jackets of the dictionaries. Chambers is for word lovers. And if you take off the dust jacket, the cover says, it stands out like a Baroque mansion against a city of faceless continents. Collins, very similarly, is the language lover's dictionary. Okay? If we compare that to sort of things that are American dictionary titles, the word you eat today, expert guidance on correct usage, the clearest advice on avoiding offensive best guidance of grammar usage, and also, you know, reflected glory by who uses your dictionary, so the official dictionary of the Associated Press. The closest thing we see to that in the British ones I've looked at is Oxford saying we're the world's most trusted dictionary. They make no promises about what they do, they just tell you about what their reputation is, that they're trusted. Okay. So what I did was I looked for dictionary archives where I could go back and see how I can see these different dictionary cultures in what the dictionaries have about themselves. And unfortunately, because of the realities of modern publishing, there are very few dictionary archives to go to. So like I called Heat Chambers, and they've been sold a couple of times, and somebody said, I think there might be a closet somewhere with some dictionary stuff in it. And I thought, I don't have time to go to Edinburgh for that. So I kept to Merriam-Webster, which has lovely records at their building in Springfield, but also the Merriam Archives at Yale University and Webster Archives at the New York Public Library and Oxford University Press's archives where they have all that information. And I've got some caveats and rationalizations about why I did that. So looking at two publishers to represent two countries, that's a bit iffy. You have to admit that. But on the other hand, you know, part of the way I justify this is that these are the names, the dictionaries in these two countries. You know, when you in America, you say, look it up, your Webster's. In America, they say, what does Oxford, or I mean, in Britain, they say, what does Oxford say? So those are sort of ones that people see as sort of the dictionary. One's an academic publisher and one's a commercial publisher. So Merriam-Webster is now owned by Encyclopedia Britannica. What's that change? Still true. Is the exchange whereas the OUP is an academic publisher. Okay, but I would say to that also, even though it makes them not quite comparable, it also tells a story that about where these best dictionary or most used dictionaries of the two places are coming from. And even if you look at the other dictionaries in the UK, they often have bases in universities, so the dictionary unit Birmingham University, Exeter University, or something like that, where lexicographers are working in the dictionary, not just working in the publishing house. It's not to say that my friends in American lexicography are not scholarly, but they've got different bosses, and that means you've got different bosses. So that's a symptom of those different dictionary cultures. And when I tried to compare the archives, I found very little in the way of marketing in the Oxford archives, and I think a lot of that is because they've done a lot less art marketing. But I think it's also because that's less what they felt was necessary to say. Okay, so there were lots of correspondence about editorial matters, there was lots about how much the lithographic plates were going to cost, things like that, but it was very little about marketing and addiction in the archives. I did, however, find a letter to the editors from my high school crush, not the same old man, he was in, kind of embarrassing, but you know, it's very fun to go through the dictionary archives and find your high school crush likes to antedate women. So, but anyway, all of this tells the story itself that dictionaries have been seen as a competitive business in the US, and there's pride in that competitiveness, whereas in the UK side, it's more of a scholarly thing. And when I tried to talk about the marketing aspects to lexicographers in England, they got a little bit more, you know, a bit less comfortable with talking about us. You know, all of, you know, so I know there are a lot of people here from different backgrounds, so I just have to give a little bit of background here, that those in lexicography will know that Merriam-Webster was, in the 19th century, a great propagandist and warrior in something called the Dictionary Wars, where they were trying to establish Webster's as the standard for the United States. and so dictionary advertising in America was huge in the 19th century, whereas dictionary making in the UK in the 19th century was very quiet until the Oxford English Dictionary started as a scholarly dictionary. So they've got that issue. Merriam-Webster has the problem that they've never copyrighted the Webster's name, so they have to constantly remind people that their dictionary is the real Webster's. And you know, you should be buying from them, so they have reason to advertise for that reason. And what they do is they advertise everywhere. You know, so I'm going through the files and I'm finding People magazine advertisements, Popular Mechanics had advertisements for Webster's dictionary. And they you know, put it toward key points where you might want to give a dictionary as a gift, like Mother's Day. Whereas Oxford, they start, so I'm looking at the 20th century, and so in the earliest 20th century, as the Oxford English Dictionary was coming out in bits, starting in the late 19th century, and as that was coming out, other publishers were starting to make desk-sized dictionaries, you know, carryable dictionaries, for general use based on the OED research. So the Oxford people thought, okay, we've got to get in here. We've got to make a book that we can sell to the public, as well as this big, you know, mini-volume scholarly dictionary. So they came into a competitive market, but, you know, in a sense, they didn't have the problem that Webster's has. Oxford was Oxford, right? And they had the goodies of the university and all that to sell it. And they also benefit. So I know that I get annoyed whenever Oxford does a press release, and they say, oh, in this week in the dictionary, we've put in, you know, some, you know, fad word at the moment. And everybody goes, oh, the Oxford English Dictionary has put in selfie. and they get all upset, and it's like, no, no, it wasn't the Oxford English Dictionary, it was the online version. But they don't mind you mixing that up, because that helps them, right? So they're not out to keep you from choosing other products. And where I could find advertisements in the Oxford files, they were advertising in things like the bookseller. So they were advertising to sellers of books, and then the sellers of books, they were not advertising directly to the public very much. Okay, and most publicity seems to be in the form of press releases. Here comes the new Oxford picture, an article about it, rather than advertising space. So to look at some ads, so this is what came out of the 19th century dictionary wars in the US, that Merriam-Webster did a huge amount of promotional stuff on every single topic. You know, so this one is a pamphlet of 50 states worth of Supreme Court judges. They found one judge in every court who was willing to say I like the Mary Munster dictionary. And the reason why they liked it was because Mary Munster had sent them one, and they were writing a thank you note, and they'd take the thank you note. And so you get these big lists of school boards. Well, you know, you get 50 school boards from 50 states, and all of that kind of thing. And this was, I like to put this in, because this is the one from promoting the dictionary to Catholics. And they had to update it because, you know, half the people in the thing were dead and the other one was in all the lunatics. But they did this, they had pamphlets for, this is why our dictionary is better than others for Catholics, because we're more kind to definitions of Catholic words. And this is why our dictionary is better for Masons or for Methodists. But also, what Merriam-Webster really did was bring in this idea that everybody had to have a dictionary. Okay, it's not just for scholars, it's not just for people who go to university, it's the friend of the farmer's family. So every farmhouse should have a dictionary next to the Bible, right? This is 20th century. Students, housewives, and businessmen, as well as students, need the same dictionary. It's good enough for all of them. And that's, again, you see commerce coming in here. So we have businessmen in the last one. So in Oxford Press, you can see some stuff about you need the dictionary for home and school. But you never see reference to business. But in Webster's, it's always home, office, and school, sometimes library. Okay? And they even like to brag about how much it costs them to make the dictionary. This dictionary cost $1.3 million to make, so that you know it's enough. And this came sort of to a head in the 50s and 60s, where they had a big campaign where they had salespeople going out into businesses. They'd go around Manhattan, go into the business, and they'd say, we think you need to be practicing SDP, Strategic Dictionary Placement. And so you need SDP was a collegiate dictionary on every desk, especially every secretary's desk, and an unabridged on one of these handsome things. I bought one of these handsome things in a junk store in Louisiana, and it wasn't until I was in the Merriam-Webster archives looking at this that I realized what I had. I had an SDP dictionary stand that, you know, you got free for buying all the dictionaries through every desk in your office. But one on a bridge per floor. In contrast, this is the only link I could find between Oxford dictionaries and business, and that's that in the 80s, they did a promotion with IBM that if you bought a case of IBM diskettes, they'd send you a free concise Oxford dictionary. And it's a special edition of the module. And there is absolutely nothing in this four-sided pamphlet about why you want a dictionary. It's entirely about why you want IBM and a dictionary. But what we see in the Merriam advertisements a lot is this association of dictionaries with self-help. With, you can improve your life, you can improve your lot by improving your English. And my favorite one is this one. One of the differences between a white collar and a blue collar could be the red jacket or a very Western collegiate. Mm-hmm. So again and again and again, through the years, the dictionary is going to make you the best. And also, there's competition for who gives the dictionary first. Be the first to give this dictionary as a graduation. Okay, and this has not changed. This is their catalog last year. Auspicious, they managed to get success, your implied success on the cover of the catalog. And again, through the years, through the most second and third, the collegiates, really specific references. Better term papers mean better grades, get a collegiate degree. A+. Versus the poor person who got a C- in the Okay. When Webster's did Webster's Third International in 1961, they needed to come up with a slightly different story because this was not the dictionary that was going to tell you this is right and this is wrong. So this dictionary was very upfront about taking a more descriptive slant on the language and not telling you that you shouldn't say ain't or things like that. And so at this point, they start sounding more like the British accent. But these went alongside the ones that implied that you'd be more successful if you had this dictionary. So they had one, you know, this is a dictionary that plans to be read for pleasure. It's not a gift for everyone. This is the elitist dictionary versus the gift for everyone. Whereas, I loved this one, I was looking through the Concise Oxford files. And there was a letter from a newspaper saying, won't you please sponsor our crossword competition? You can give away a free dictionary every week after naming our paper. And there was this whole back and forth between the editors going, do we really want to be seen in that kind of play? Won't this downgrade our scholarly reputation to be associated with the crossword book? And somebody, 1976 was still being considered. And they finally gave in the 80s and started sponsoring, being a prize for the television show Countdown. But it took a long time to get to that point where the diction could be about everybody and not just about being a scholarly repository. And this was the New Oxford Dictionary of English, 1998. That started to look a bit more American in various ways. So you know, it had usage paragraphs after things like hopefully to say, well, you know, not everybody thinks you should use this as a sentential adverb. But it does generally take a descriptive stance on these issues. It's just willing to discuss them a bit more. And so it did this, again, this is a press release. This is how they're advertised in the dictionaries, not by putting an ad in Hello Magazine, but by putting it out to the press. Okay, but they're very clear here still that they're in the description of English. They're not trying to tell you what the standard language is. And I have to say, this was given to me by one of the Lex conferences. Oh yeah, we did that kind of advertisement once. That's about descriptions. And then we never did that. He was kind of there. So those are the differences that I found. And I think they do tell a story about the place of the dictionary in America as, if not actually being a tool of self-help, although I don't know if any of you have read I can't think of her name. Founding Grammars. Rose Rouser's book, Founding Grammars, where she looks at how different grammar books affected different presidents. And you know, to see somebody like Lincoln using published grammar dictionaries as self-help, you know, that tells a story that gets told again and again in American classrooms and but what the dictionary means to us, not quite the same way. So the question I'm going to end on is, what about the 21st century? This is about print dictionaries, but yeah, I purposefully stayed in the 20th century where it was sort of easier to think about these things than lazy that way. but if you look in the 20th century, for instance, if you compare studies of how often the U.S. Supreme Court uses dictionaries to make decisions versus what I've been able to find in the UK Supreme Court, it's at a rate about 10 times more. So a dictionary is that sort of thing that you go to as something that gives us the rules, gives us the facts, that self-help thing that we can rely on that's unambiguous. In the 20th century, we can see language changing in certain directions. And this has been going on throughout the 20th century, but English has changed in America because of style books. So for instance, Strunk and White's don't use the passive. The passive has been going down in printed American English at a much faster rate than it's been going down in printed British English. The distinction between that which, that's something that Americans care about, that British people don't care about, or it's certain, I don't know, you have to say, very certain Americans care about. But, you know, these kinds of things do speak to a culture that likes to have written down rules about language that are kind of unambiguous. And you can look at that, and I'm sure most of us in this room are descriptivists at heart, and we think, oh, you know, these poor people being bamboozled into believing all these rules about language that are sort of hampering in a way that make them more insecure about the language. But one of the things I talk about in The Prodigal Tongue is I also see the positive side of that. That this is a culture that's saying, here, we're going to make the rules clear for everybody, and you can find them at the public library. And that, it's not a simple story, it's a complicated story, but that's something that I think I take a little bit of heart in as an American, just to answer for American English all the time. So, thank you very much for listening.
The punctuation changes. the United States makes me wonder about something that comes up a lot with my British versus American friends. So they're constantly talking, my UK friends are constantly talking about how American usage is encroaching on them. And I've just assumed it's because we're culturally such busybodies. But could it be because we're more prolific on the subject of usage itself?
I would say there is some influence being felt in Britain, but a lot of that is because you've got British authors writing for publishing houses who want to sell in both places, and so those publishing houses will go a little bit more Americanized on the grammatical things and stuff and stuff like that. In terms of the general, and this is very much at the heart of the book, in terms of the general British concern that American English is going to displace British things, that's usually about vocabulary, and that's usually about things people hear on television. It's about my kids saying awesome. It's not about what's reasonable. Site which has all those things on it. What I am doing with the Hansard, so that I was asked to raise hands, the Hansard, which is the parliamentary record. The UK has only had a Supreme Court since 2009. Before that, it was the House of Lords. So it would be good for me to go back and look more at the House of Lords. But there's an interesting House of Lords decision that's since been cited in UK Supreme Court decisions where they say, the meaning of a word doesn't live in a dictionary, it lives in context. And so, sort of saying, don't use dictionaries to make your decisions in court. I mean, it's not explicitly saying it, but it's there. Versus what's happening in the US, where it's like, we have to decide whether this is art or pornography, let's look up art and pornography in whatever dictionary is closest to me and make a decision based on.
Something that your talk reminded me of was the fact that the SAT tests for vocab. And so I went through the British education system, and when I came across this vocabulary portion, I was just like, what is this? Do you think that's relevant to what you're doing? Is there a connection there?
I think it is. So the question is...
Well, more like an observation.
Yeah.
But
the question is about the SAT test for college entrance here. Now that you're tested on your vocabulary in various ways. You're asked multiple choice, what's this word mean? You're also asked to do analogies between words and things like that. There's nothing like that in the British educational system. I as a student in America came home with vocabulary lists that I was quizzed on once or twice a week, depending on how close I was to SAT year. Nothing like that in the British system. And so that's another thing that I talk about in the book, and I cut out of the talk to make it a bit shorter, is that how English is treated as a subject in the two countries and how the skills are treated in the two countries is really different. So for instance, to get into university there, you don't take general aptitude tests like the SATs, you take specialist tests in the subject that you're going to major in at university. But also, once you get to the university, nobody ever teaches you how to write an essay, which is, what you do for the first term of university and often another term after that in an American college. So there's no such thing as freshman writing, freshman comp in the British system. And I asked my lovely Oxford-educated colleague, when I first got there, it was like, well, when do students learn how to write? He says, well, the ones who read a lot will, pick it up. So that's that learning by osmosis thing versus everybody can be a good writer. Yes, we can. I have a lot of time for both education systems. I've taught, but I think, I love the yes, we can. How true it is. I don't really know. But I love democracy,
the Brits pioneered Learner's Dictionary, yes. which is self-help par excellence.
Yeah.
So how does that fit
yeah.
in with, you know?
I do cover that a bit in the book. So the question is, the Brits pioneered self-help, pioneered second language dictionaries. How does that compare to what I'm talking about here? Because second language dictionaries are self-help dictionaries. And they're very different in a lot of ways to the kinds of dictionaries that we're looking at here. And what I find interesting about that is that the British dictionary industry is very international facing. Some of the publishers no longer publish dictionaries that are first language dictionaries. So something like Macmillan is really aimed out toward learners rather than, say for secondary school students or things like that. And so it's Britain, having spread English around the world, now has a big industry devoted to English out in the world. Things like the tests, students who take tests for getting into English-speaking universities take British house tests rather than the TOEFL. And so there's this whole competition for the English speakers out there, and Britain is taking that competition seriously, and America just isn't. America has left people to sell dictionaries to within the country, and it has been immigrants wanting to learn English that have fueled the American dictionary culture as well. But the way I see that difference is, yes, you're expected to need to learn English if you don't speak English. But if you've grown up in English, you were expected to get it by the services. And there's an interesting difference there also with the English education system versus the Scottish education system. And the Scottish education system has always been a bit more, American education was more based on the Scottish than the English, because they wanted more of that explicit teaching language skills, because not everybody in Scotland would have had them back in the 19th century. Sorry.
Here's actually just looking for a comment, basically, following up on the rules I understand. Well, actually, two. One of them is it can serve an influence on that, the Oxford Dictionary of English, since it was, Patrick Hanks is the one who read it, they didn't let him do it at all, dictionary style, but you can certainly see influence there. But what's interesting is that with a lot of court cases and stuff that use dictionaries, is that learners' dictionaries, I think, would be much more appropriate to be used in courts. Because one of the big comments that's a criticism that's made of using dictionaries is that dictionary definitions are very incontextual. And especially, they're totally incontextualized, because they want to make it very independent and abstract and analytical. And it's really gets zero help for knowing which sense will go into what kind of context, unless you really are a very sophisticated dictionary user and realize that for the three-word example in Webster's Unabridged is the context that's to should cleave into the context it's supposed to be used in. And those cases, these Supreme Court cases, if they had looked at the Cobell dictionary or something, it would have been decided differently.
And that's enough, so that relates, so this is about the second language dictionaries might be better for these court cases that are being said in America. And related to, one thing I'd say about that is my students come to me, university students, native speakers of English, I say, if you want to know about a word, look it up in the learner's dictionary first. Because there they do get explicit about the detail in the way that is often taken for granted in the other dictionaries.
I would caution, as a publisher of learners' dictionaries, against ever using them in a court. There's two reasons. One is that every dictionary house has its own proprietary corpus.
Yeah.
And for instance, the Cobill one, the original one, was all newspapers because they didn't have to pay for context. Yes, our dictionaries give more context about the behavior of words, but we are constrained, well, the second point, we're constrained by a restricted defining vocabulary, right? So the definitions are never, ever, by, you know, per force, as precise as the ones can be in a native dictionary. You kind of need both, is what I'm saying.
Yeah,
so
you need not
a dictionary as if it were gone.
Yeah, if you are going to use a dictionary to inform your choice, you need to look at 10 dictionaries.
It's very alarming.
But the other point I wanted to follow up on there is that's another big difference between British and American dictionary cultures. British dictionaries pioneered the use of corpora, and American dictionaries came much later to that, and you see that in how they don't in any sort of organism.
It's also very interesting how the two cultures are propagated in other countries. So I just did a study in Slovenia of 17 students, and out of them, only one even knew Merriam-Webster Learner's Dictionary at all. The others mostly use British dictionaries, primarily Oxford Advanced Learners. On the other hand, only one spoke a variant of British English, all of them spoke American English. And on the issue of example sentences, that is, for the average user, that is one of the big issues they have when they confront any dictionary, at least these average users in Slovenia who are college students.
I mean, when I was writing the book, I tried to find out how big the American English language exporting industry is. You can find those numbers very easily for Britain because it is a huge industry there. Between testing and dictionaries and textbooks and sending people out to teach, it is a huge industry there that they will tell you things, you know, how many, over many billion pounds to the economy each year. You can't find those figures for America because it's such a small job.
How has the book been received differently in Britain and the U.S. so far in terms of reviews and what you can tell from the wide reaction?
The reviews have generally been good. but in two cases, in British reviews, if you fly British Airways, you can read one that says that I'm sometimes a bit chippy. I have a chip on my shoulder. And
but in which direction?
In the British people gotta get over it kind of direction. But in those cases, I do sort of think that there were two cases like that, and I did sort of feel like they didn't see the twinkle in my eye, and I'm not sure they read all the way through. So,
okay, I think we should leave it there. Thank you.